Godbound is my favourite game. I've run it for about 5 years at this point, and I'm still not tired of it. It's a D20 system where the PCs are demigods, and it's perhaps the truest sandbox game out there because of it. After all, the big bad evil guy of your standard D&D campaign, the one who the PC spends level 1 to 20 trying to take down, can probably be dealt with by a pantheon of Godbound in a session or two. It's far from a perfect system, and I've written up a ton of homebrew just to make it run more smoothly now that I got a few campaigns under my belt. But I love it, warts and all. This is the story of the first campaign I ever ran in the system. I'd been interested in Godbound system ever since another friend ran a campaign for me, and a few friends, that only lasted a few sessions before he flaked on it, like every other game he tried running before. And I'd learned that if I ever wanted to do anything in a system, I'd need to run it myself. I've already told a little anecdote from this campaign, but I think I'm going to try telling the whole thing. The lockdown has taken a bit of a toll on me, and reminiscing about the good old days cheers me up a bit. Some things you should know going into this. Number 1. The story will ultimately end on an anti-climax. The game fell apart due to tensions between myself and some of the players, but it fortunately fell apart after the end of the major arc, so there will at least be some closure. Also, it went on for a couple of years before falling apart, so there's a good few stories to tell before we reach that point. And number 2. I'm something of a long-winded storyteller, but I'll do my best to keep things concise. Be me. GM. Be not me. PCs. PC number 1. Lind Tungensen. Bound to death, fertility and passion. Lind is a 16-year-old young man from a place in the far north called the Ulstein Skerries.
Sounds very scary. I couldn't help myself, I'm sorry.
Go away. It's ruled by a cabal of necromancer queens who send their Viking minions raiding in the south to bring back corpses and treasure for their dread mistress. Lind fled the Skerries because he was capable of magic, something that's forbidden to men in that land, and was secretly guided by his mentor, Odin, though Lind didn't know this at the time, to a safer land, along with his family. PC number 2. Kadesh. Bound to fire, sky, and sun. Kadesh was a former prince of the Oasis States, fantasy ancient Egypt with a lot more magic and breeding. He had attempted to conquer the Oasis in his name, like a lot of the other insane god nobles that rule there. On the battlefield, he saw a vision of Ra, and his madness was miraculously cured. Horrified by what he'd done in the name of his own vanity, he took on the name Kadesh to distance himself from his past, and set out into the new world to make amends. PC number 3. Uptronix Prime. Bound to endurance, might, and shapeshifting. In case you can't tell, Uptronix Prime is Optimus Prime with the serial numbers filed off.
That's actually kind of cool, sir. That's actually not too bad.
He came from a dead world that was his god when it was alive. Think Cybertron stand-in. But his nemesis, Apollyon, accidentally killed it in a war that destroyed their world. Uptronix came to Arkham, pronounced Arkham. Good boy, why do more
Cheers.
People not do this for me? Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Where the game takes place, seeking a new home for his people. PC number 4. Hamilcar Brizan. Bound to alacrity, command, and sword. This is apparently a reference to a historical general that I don't know much about, but I can assure you that the character was played absolutely nothing like that great figure.
Let us know in the comments. I'm going to assume it's Hamilcar Barca.
I don't think there's that many people with Hamilcar as a name, so...
Well, no, Hamilcar, you should have seen Carthage. I'm not even joking, they have, like, 5 names, and every con's called Hamilcar. Or, like, there's, like, 3 names, and, it's really bad. If you ever get into the Punic Wars, it's ridiculous.
Okay.
Because you think, oh, wait, they're talking about him again. This guy really gets about. It's like, no, wait, it's, all the brothers have got the same names.
Hamilcar was the great knight general of Ancalia prior to its fall. A kingdom of dark-skinned people who practiced magic eugenics in order to make super soldiers, and was also secretly the king's bastard son. Hamilcar had his suspicions of this prior to the start of the campaign, but no concrete proof. If you read the original story, you'll notice that 2 of the PCs are different. This is because they switch characters about halfway through the campaign. We open on a shot looking out of a window into an inky blackness, with the sound of a train engine chugging faintly in the background. Panning back, we see that this is the inside of a train car, with our 4 heroes seated in the bench seats. Uptronix in particular, comically taking up most of the room on his side of the cabin. None of them know how they got there. A few of them make intelligence checks, Godbind roll raw attributes instead of skills because they're good at everything, to try and remember how they got there. Hamilcar and Kadesh both succeed and have hazy memories of walking through golden halls. They were with their present company, but there were several other people there. A man dressed in all black, his face obscured by his hood, leads them through the halls, chattering idly. Suddenly they are attacked by someone firing a hail of arrows at them, though they didn't get a good look at the attacker. The man in black assures them that the others will handle the attackers and they need to come with him. They enter a room, and then all memory ceases until they wake up here in the train. Hamilcar notices that he's holding what appears to be a circlet, or maybe a crown of some kind, made of a golden material and covered in intricate engravings. He has no clue how he got it, but all four of them can sense on an instinctive level that the thing radiates divine power. Optronix, not knowing who any of these people he's sharing a cabin with, speaks up and makes a formal introduction, explaining as much of his backstory as the other PCs will allow before cutting him off. Hamilcar and Kadesh both explain what little they can remember, and the four of them take a moment to try and figure out what exactly is going on. Lind squeezes past Optronix to open the cabin door, and is greeted by a tall automaton made of polished brass with a blank faceplate. The automaton politely asks if there's anything he can get for his honoured guests. Lind stammers, no, we're fine, but can you tell us where we are? The automaton cheerily informs them that they are aboard the Night Express, the finest and only interdimensional rail service.
Wait, was this not a Christmas movie?
This was, with Tom Hanks.
This was a Christmas movie.
It also informs them that they are some of the first guests on this fine enterprise, and it would be oh so very grateful if they give a good review upon the completion of their journey. Lynn thanks the automaton and closes the door. The Pantheon begins talking next, and Optronix slims down to a more human appearance, which just so happens to resemble Peter Cullen,
the voice actor for Optus, yeah. Behind the curtain.
Kadesh suggests that they explore the train and the rest agree, with Kadesh taking the lead. The train is mostly empty, populated almost entirely by the brass automata, but they are informed that there is another guest in the dining car. They are also informed that it would be prudent not to fall off the train, as doing so would land them in the uncreated night, the primordial nothing between realms, and there is no known way to retrieve someone lost in such a manner. The Pantheon arrives in the dining car and finds the man dressed in black sitting at the bar. When I say dressed in black, I mean not an inch of skin is showing. He's wearing a black coat with a hood pulled up, black pants and boots, and his hands are even covered in black gloves. When he turns his head to look at them, it becomes apparent that there's nothing but an empty void beneath his hood, but that isn't preventing him from enjoying his drink. Hamilcar and Kadesh confirm that this is the same man from their vision. The man, for his part, hops down off his stool and gives each of them a friendly greeting, chattering away in a chipper tone while shaking each of their hands in turn. He begins to congratulate them on a job well done, but Kadesh interrupts, informing him that none of them know who he is or why they're there. The man in black nods and lifts a hand up to rub his non-existent chin. Well, I suppose that's to be expected. While we managed to save the looms of fate, it was slightly damaged in the process. I was able to do some emergency repairs, but the timeline might have become a bit unstable in the process. Questions and answers reveal that the man in black is known as the Undisputed Master. Hey, I can't pick what my father named me. And that he had chosen several champions to aid him in preventing angels from destroying the loom of fate, with the only survivors of the endeavour standing in the room. An intelligence check from Lind confirms that this is something angels would do. They're pissed at humanity for driving them out of heaven and into hell as the start of the last war, and have been trying to eradicate humanity ever since. I'd get off here if I were you, explains TEM. This is the last stop for Arkham, and I don't think you'll be able to get back home where I'm going. Hamilcar rolls a whiz check to see if the Undisputed Master had lied to them at any point in the conversation. He learns that he's utterly incapable of determining whether anything Tom says is a lie, but his explanation does seem to be consistent with what he and Kadesh remembers, and does fill in a few gaps. Optronix attempts to press Tom for more information, but I requested all of the PCs to make a spirit save. This game's save to resist mental and emotional effects, and they all fail. None of them want to spend effort to automatically succeed, either. The Pantheon suddenly finds himself standing on the platform outside of the train, which is currently pulling out of the station. One of the brass automata greets them with a clipboard, asking if any of them would care to answer a survey.
For fuck's sake, even if when you're a demigod, you can't avoid the fucking surveys.
Fuck's sake. Kadesh and Optronix, both being the polite sort, answer it to the best of their ability, while Lind and Hamilcar leave to explore the station. The station looks like something straight out of the 1920s, with an art deco style, but doesn't seem to extend much further than the platform, which appears to be the only thing of substance besides the track inside of a featureless void. They follow the steps leading down from the platform and exiting through a stone archway into some crumbling ruins. The train is only accessible through this archway, and walking around behind it reveals only thin air. Lind, being bound to death, also quickly realizes that the ruin is crawling with zombies. As a god of death, Lind has the ability to command up to a vast mob, the size of a small army, of lesser undead as an action. Rather than fighting their way through, Lind just tells the zombies to gather in a distant corner of the ruins and stay there.
Go to the corner,
turn around, and just stay there.
Lee doesn't have any dunce hearts he can give them all. Yeah.
The Pantheon regroup and walk out. Hamilcar quickly realizes they're in Alcalia, his homeland. Alcalia is a pretty standard medieval kingdom that is currently experiencing a major case of zombie apocalypse, and there have been rumored sightings of strange aberrant creatures attacking travelers and villagers as well. Hamilcar takes a moment to get his bearings, then starts leading the Pantheon towards the nearest town. The town is on the outskirts of a larger city, and there are regular militia patrols to drive off wandering undead. Hamilcar knows that this is not uncommon, and there really aren't sleepy towns in the middle of nowhere anymore, because they were all quickly overrun when the zombie plague swept across the land. I call for a whiz check, and everyone passes. They notice strangers in dark clothing lurking on the outskirts of town, watching the townsfolk with suspicious eyes. They carry strange, saw-like weapons, and move away hastily if confronted. Lind and Hamilcar do some information gathering. Lind discovers that the strange men are known locally as huntsmen, and while the townsfolk distrust them, they can be persuaded to take payment in exchange for hunting down some of the more dangerous monsters. Occasionally they demand children in lieu of coin, but some towns are desperate enough to take that bargain. Hamilcar discovers that the nearby city is actually ruled over by one of his former acquaintances, Sir Alfarius Brar. Sir Brar was the head of the Glorificent Knightly Order, one of the seven great orders of knighthood in Alcalia before the Calamity. As the Knight General, the man who coordinated these knightly orders, Hamilcar had regular dealings with Brar. Hamilcar knows that Brar is a hard ass, but he takes his duties seriously and comports himself honourably. The Pantheon decides to enter the city, where they see a man being whipped to death for stealing rations. Food is scarce, so the punishment for stealing is harsh. Lind takes mercy on the thief and steps forward to interrupt the execution. He uses a fertility gift to heal the man, then uses a miracle to produce enough food to replace what he stole 1,000 times over. The execution is immediately forgotten as the onlookers stare in awe at the massive pile of food that just appeared out of thin air. It's even fresh, not steel rations that taste like dirt. Hamilcar senses that a food riot is imminent as everyone starts crowding around, so steps forward and uses a command gift to organize the crowd. In accordance with his bellowing voice, everyone in attendance lines up and takes a single serving from the pile, with any leftovers being transported to the local stockpile. Kadesh activates the sun gift, Hope of the Dawn, which is primarily used as a combat buff, but can also be used to soothe fears and tensions, to ease crowds' desperation, and begins handing out food besides Lind. Once everyone present has received their fair share, Optronix uses his titanic strength to lift the remaining rations single-handedly and carry them to the stockpile. Needless to say, this stunt attracted the attention of the guards. Thanks to some excellent charisma rolls all round, the guards aren't hostile to the Pantheon, but they are a bit wary. People who can conjure food out of thin air are a threat to the order Sir Brar has established, and they're trying to make sure that the PCs aren't here to cause trouble. After all, they've heard about mysterious strangers who have wandered into the town offering salvation, only to start dark cults for the entire town's population to go missing. It's just part and parcel with living in Ancalia these days. Fortunately for the guards, who wouldn't have stood a snowball's chance in hell if they tried to start trouble with the Pantheon, Hamilcar agrees to go with them to see Brar. Sir Brar is an older man than Hamilcar by a few decades. Hamilcar was only 20 or so when he was appointed as Knight General, and Sir Brar had always harboured a bit of grudge for that. Brar knew that Hamilcar was the king's bastard son, and believed that Hamilcar had achieved his position through nepotism rather than merit. This was only partially true, since Hamilcar had become a godbound around the same time that he'd received his position, and as such, could far outshine any of the lords that led the knightly orders. Hamilcar barely manages to succeed a rather difficult charisma check to endear himself to Brar, who is more than a little suspicious of Hamilcar and his companions. After all, if they can produce more food for the people than he can, Brar could quickly be out of the job. However, Hamilcar's successful check means that he's willing to trust in Hamilcar's honour as a knight, and he decides to cooperate with him. Brar asks Lind to produce more food when he gets a chance. However, he has some slightly more pressing concerns. His scouts have discovered a massive horde of zombies approaching from the south, and they're moving in a much more coordinated manner than the typical shamblers. Something is controlling these undead, and he needs someone to figure out what, and hopefully to stop it before it arrives at his gates. Brar would go himself, however, he has much to oversee in the running of the city, and someone needs to lead the last line of defence, in case the horde can't be stopped in time. The PCs agree to investigate, and Brar gives them all horses, as well as the last known location of the zombie horde. The PCs ride for a few days, performing a series of minor heroic deeds and miracles along the way. Lind uses his training as a low magic, mortal magic, hedge wizard to cure a plague in a village they pass through. Optronix digs out a group of miners trapped in a cave with his bare hands. Kadesh calms an unnatural storm that had been ravaging another small village for days on end. And Hamilcar defeats a group of bandits by himself, then organises them into a defence militia for the village Kadesh saved. Finally, they see the horde that Brar was talking about on the horizon. Kadesh uses a sun miracle to enhance his vision, allowing him to closely examine the horde from miles away. Brar's reports were correct. The zombies weren't shambling, but rather marching in regiment ranks, like well-drilled soldiers. Hamilcar suggests that they simply ride out and dispatch the horde before it can cause any trouble, a plan that Optronix and Kadesh agree with. Lind wanted to observe the horde a bit longer, but consents to riding along with the Pantheon. In the opening round of combat, Lind attempts to use his death ability to seize control of the horde, like he had done earlier in the session, but discovers that some other force is already controlling them. They have a brief contest of wills, which Lind only barely loses, meaning that he and his companions are going to have to fight. Kadesh flies into the sky, well out of the reach of the zombies, and begins hurling bolts of lightning down at them like javelins. Hamilcar draws his sword and charges forward on his horse, cutting down scores of the undead with each stroke. Optronix lifts a massive boulder and hurls it into the army, crushing many of them in the process. The zombies are all lesser foes, meaning that they had as many or fewer hit dice as the PCs have levels. So even though they have the advantage of numbers, they don't pose a major threat. In the first turn, the PCs have reduced the entire army to half strength before it even got a chance to attack. Hey guys, sorry to interrupt the video, but it's time for some self-promo. So over the past few months, more and more of our videos have been getting demonetized than usual. A few people have asked about setting up a Patreon, and it's not really our thing. We would much rather you check out some of our other sponsors or buy some of our models. But some people have still been asking for a Patreon, so why not? So the Patreon is nothing special, and we're not offering anything but our general channel support. If you guys have any ideas you would like to see in rewards, definitely let us know down below. It really does help us make more videos our YouTube overlords would disapprove of. Also, for you guys that dislike Patreon, because we know a lot of people can be iffy on them, we have a Ko-fi for one-off donations. We also just want to say a big thank you to anyone who does support the channel. If it's checking out the sponsors or buying the models, or even if you just sub to us and keep coming back for our videos, we really, really thank you. Let's get back to the video. The zombies try to attack the PCs they can reach, which is just Hamilcar and Optronix, since Lind hung back on his horse and Kadesh is flying above them, striking with the discipline of well-drilled soldiers. But at the end of the day, they're only barely stronger than regular mortals. And their attacks bounce harmlessly off of Optronics, and Hamilcar effortlessly parries all of their blows. In the following round, Lind uses White Bone Harvest, a gift that lets him destroy all lesser undead he can see, to drop the rest of the horde, sparing a couple so that he can try and trace the force controlling them. He succeeds in intelligence check and determines that whatever's controlling the undead is further south, near the border with the Oasis States. The Pantheon travel for another few days and discover a relatively small pyramid. You know, Giza-sized, rather than mountain-sized, like the Oasis States are famous for. Outside are a few hundred mummies that are guarding the gates to the entrance. Lind once more attempts to control these lesser undead and wins the contest of wills this time, having the mummies lay down their weapons. While the other PCs are determining the best way to enter the pyramid, Lind decides to investigate the mummies further. It turns out that they're not mindless undead. They have human souls trapped within them that have been driven mad after being ritually buried alive and kept awake throughout their undeath for centuries. They're barely coherent anymore, so he uses White Bone Harvest again to give them peace. Meanwhile, Optronics and Hamilcar have come to a decision. Kadesh's expertise in the Oasis States has confirmed that this pyramid is likely the tomb of someone very important, and as such, is almost certainly filled to the brim with death traps. Nice. So Optronics and Hamilcar decide that, rather than walking through all the rooms that are obviously filled with traps, they're just going to punch or cut holes in the wall until they get to the burial chamber, with Kadesh acting as a guide. The Pantheon gets to work, with Hamilcar and Optronics' unconventional approach to trap finding outright obliterating most of the traps before they even have a chance to activate. They hit a slight snag about halfway through, however, when Optronics accidentally punches his way through a large tank of liquid. Being made of metal, he's immune to the contact poison that's filled in the tank. However, his friends are all made of flesh, and the poison is rushing towards them quickly. Kadesh steps forward and uses a fire miracle to instantly evaporate all of the poison in the blink of an eye, causing something from the inside of the tank to let out a monstrous roar of pain. It turns out that a small pack of mummified crocodiles have made their home in the poison tank, their undead state making them immune to the poison. And while Kadesh's stunt had killed most of them, three had survived. Optronics opens combat by grabbing one of the crocodiles and snapping its spine over his knee, like Bane. Oh no, leave Crocky alone! Hamilcar dashes forward and guts a second, but rolls low on damage and doesn't quite kill it. Kadesh has already acted this round, but moves so that he can get a better view into the tank for the start of his next one. Lind activates Scythe Hand, a combat gift that allows him to wield death and decay as a weapon, and hits the third crocodile for maximum damage, killing it. The crocodile Hamilcar is fighting manages a very lucky roll and actually manages to bite into his arm, but only deals 2 points of damage. For context, damage in Godbound is nasty. Instead of suffering damage to your hit points, you lose entire hit dice. As such, a blow that deals 4 damage could drop them level 4 adventurer in a single hit. Your average Godbind has around 8 to 10 hit dice at level 1, so while 2 points of damage is more than enough to kill a common soldier twice over, it's barely a tickle to a demigod. Kadesh finishes off the crocodile by incinerating it, and Lind uses his magic to heal Hamilcar back up to full. The group proceeds a bit more cautiously from this point, and finally makes it to the antechamber to the grand tomb of the pyramid. What appears to be the scattered bones of several cows are scattered about the room, but the PCs pay them no mind, striding towards the doors of the burial chamber. Hamilcar takes the lead, and as he steps into the middle of the chamber, the bones begin to stir and assemble themselves. The Pantheon find themselves surrounded by a small mob, enough creatures to fill your average tavern of skeletal minotaurs. Optronics, being thoroughly done with the death trap dungeon, steps forward and activates Loosening God's Teeth on one of the Might Word's strongest damage dealing abilities, and rolls just under his maximum damage. He yells for his friends to duck and rips a pillar out of the wall, then swings it in a wide arc, smashing all of the minotaurs into fine bone powder with a single blow. He then hurls the remains of the pillar like a javelin through the doors to the burial chamber, smashing them open. Inside a chamber that's the size of a small mansion, with gold and jewels laying all around. In the centre, atop the raised platform is a massive golden sarcophagus. A roar of displeasure can be heard throughout the chamber, and the lid of the sarcophagus is hurled off, crashing into a mountain of gold coins. Out of the sarcophagus rises a mummified dragon, eyes glowing green with necromantic fury. "Who dares disturb the rest of God Pharaoh Nadar?" it demands. Kadesh steps forward and responds, "A humble servant of Ra." He glances to Lind, who confirms that the dragon is indeed the one who's been controlling all of the undead they've encountered so far. "In the name of the Sun God, I command you to release the dead under your control. They have suffered enough, and are causing yet further suffering through your command." The dragon scoffs. "You wouldn't have the King of the Dead relinquish his crown. Preposterous." Kadesh simply nods solemnly, and begins burning with the brilliance of the sun. He opens with Sunstrike, a powerful sun smite that calls down a beam of solar flame that burns through everything in its path that's not made of divine construction to strike its target. Since the pyramid is made of mundane stone, Nadar suffers some nasty burns and has a gaping hole in the roof of his tomb. Lind attacks with Scythe Hand, but misses. However, even on a miss, Scythe Hand will always deal at least 1 point of damage to a living or undead target. Hamilcar activates the Stormbreaks, an alacrity gift that gives him an entire second round of actions on the first round of combat, and slashes twice at the dragon's hind legs, causing him to stumble and fall prone as he exits his sarcophagus. Optronix is out of effort for the day, but is still one of the strongest beings in the universe. Rather than attack right away, however, he holds his action, suspecting that Nadar might try to use some powerful abilities of his own in retaliation. And he's correct. I announce that Nadar is going to unleash his breath weapon, but Optronix springs into action. As Nadar is about to spew forth a torrent of acid, Optronix leaps forward and grapples the dragon, slamming his jaws shut and holding them closed. Spurts of acid spew out through Nadar's nostrils and empty eye sockets, but they're too unfocused to hit anyone. Nadar uses his second action to try and break free from the grapple, but Optronix is stronger and holds firm. Start of the next turn. Optronix attacks by shoulder throwing Nadar through several columns. Kadesh hurls a bolt of lightning which strikes the dragon between the eyes, dazing him. And Hamilcar finishes the stunned beast off by dashing forward and decapitating it with a stroke of his sword. Nadar's head falls to the ground, and the lights burning in his eye sockets gutter out and die. And that was the end of the first Godbound adventure I'd ever run. It served as a tutorial for both my players and I, who were largely unfamiliar with the system, but overall we had a great time with it. One of the things I really enjoyed about this session was that the players were very creative, with both the social and combat uses their gifts had. And I was a little worried that the Pantheon would turn into a group of divine murder hobos. However, this session quelled my fears of that for a time. As you'll see going forward, one of the players makes some unfortunate decisions and does become a bit too stab happy. But the rest of the PCs turned into largely beneficent deities who preferred to talk when at all possible.
Well guys, I hope you enjoyed that. The author of this story actually sent it in to us, and we did a small section of one like from the same game in
a while ago.
Like about 2 weeks ago, I think it was now, maybe three.
Maybe it was a wee bit longer than, we did do it.
We did part of this story, and the guy really enjoyed it, so he's like, "Oh, you do want us to do more?" It's like, "Well, yeah, sure, why not?" I always enjoy doing anything that's different from Forgotten Realms. See if it's Shadowrun, see if it's called Cthulhu, any of that type of shit, I'm automatically more interested in, almost. Yeah, you know what I mean?
There's so many D&D stories.
Yeah, there's so many, like.
So many.
Just
generic. We're getting something a bit different.
It's nice. I enjoy it.
Yeah.
However, this could be a very long, multi-part story. I don't know exactly what's happening yet. I don't really want to get into a big, long multi-parter, but if you guys really enjoy it, I'm sure we could do it every now and again as it comes. You know what I mean? So let us know what you thought about this one. It's very different from what we normally do, but I enjoy it. I thought it was cool. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So remember, like, comment, subscribe, check out the advert, all that other good shit, and you can hear our dog walking about in the background.
Yeah. His name's Please Odie. Go away.
His name's Odie, and he's a very, very good boy. So hope you guys enjoy, and we'll see you later.
Bye.